Hello everyone from X, your favorite alien. So, if you've watched the 6 previous videos, by now you should have learned how to build the sensor. Detect magnetic orbitals in 2D. Reconstruct the shapes in 3D. Verify the accuracy of those shapes using another magnet. Recognize how these magnetic bubbles interact when multiple magnets are involved. And even apply this method to electromagnets. These are the key innovations introduced by this research. So now we know, there are public, simple, zero-cost experiments that support all the claims in this experimental part of the study, even if it hasn't been peer-reviewed. And that was exactly Marsio's main goal, making experiments repeatable by everyone, not just by journal reviewers. This way, each of you can easily reproduce the experiments with your own hands and form your own opinion. So please, if you enjoy this kind of work, try it yourself. We need your confirmations, because in the end, you will be our reviewers. Thank you. Perfect. From now on, we'll focus on a far more delicate aspect, trying to explain why all of this happens. Of course, this will be a bit more speculative, but after years of experiments, reasoning, and countless discussions, including with advanced artificial intelligences, Marsio has managed to bring together some very interesting concepts to strengthen his final hypothesis. Namely, that what we are seeing is more likely to belong to quantum mechanics rather than classical mechanics, even though these experiments take place in the macroscopic world. And yes, this is where things get serious. When we measure a magnetic field with a traditional sensor, we've always been taught to believe we're observing the objective reality of the field. Maxwell describes a field, we measure it, and that measurement is supposedly a direct snapshot of reality. But in Marsio's experiments, things don't work that way at all. Why? Because the sensor itself, say a Hall sensor, is not a neutral observer. It is in every sense a small magnet. And like any magnet, it interacts with the system it's measuring. Which means that what we are tracing is not the field itself, but the form the field takes when it enters into a relationship with the second element. And there's more. Marsio's method is completely different from FEM simulations or classical vector measurements. He doesn't record continuous values, he scans point by point the inversions of polarity. At a fixed angle, reset after reset, plane after plane, he reconstructs not the average strength of the field, but its nodal structure. And it's precisely there that, for example, a toroid with inverted polarity appears. Something invisible to traditional maps, but real and reproducible. In other words, we're not drawing the present, we're drawing the future. The measurement does not reveal what the field is in isolation, but how it will react if another magnet comes into play with the same geometry and orientation. And this is where the parallel with quantum mechanics becomes inevitable. The electron orbital does not exist as a fixed object floating in space, but as a probability distribution. Only when we observe it, does it collapse into a concrete configuration. The same thing happens here. Every measurement is already an interaction, and every interaction creates a new reality. That's why Marsio states, the magnetic field in purity is inaccessible and will always remain so. What we can see is only its prophecy of interaction. Magnetic orbitals work like this. They are not snapshots. They are embodied predictions. And if instead of the sensor we place a magnet, the interaction unfolds exactly as the sensor had already drawn it. Now someone might object, aren't you just tracing isolines of the field? Isn't this just a classical picture? The answer is no. And here's why. An isoline shows a value of intensity at one instant. Maxwell's way, a photograph of the present. With nodal scanning, however, entirely new figures emerge. Figures that, as we've shown in previous videos, provide genuine predictions of interactions. And those predictions coincide with already known quantum geometries, which behave in the very same way at the microscopic scale. Atomic orbitals are described as regions of probability. The magnetic field instead manifests as regions of varying intensity. The drop in magnetic intensity with distance is analogous to the probabilistic blur of the orbital. It's the same logic, maps that don't capture an absolute present, but sketch out possible futures. Up to this point, the experimental confirmations of Marsio's hypothesis, that all of this follows the rules of quantum mechanics, are four. One, all the geometries detected match in fine detail the atomic orbitals described by quantum mechanics. Two, each measurement does not represent the current state of the field, but anticipates a probable future interaction. Three, if I replace the sensor with a magnet, the real interaction follows the prediction, just as real atomic interactions follow the predictions of Schrödinger's equation. Four, the construction of the shapes is comparable between electronic probability distributions and the magnetic intensity that decreases with distance. Put these clues together and the picture becomes clearer. Measurement is a creative act. It is the act that forces the field to take form. And here comes one of the first real conclusions. Exactly as in quantum mechanics, where an orbital collapses only when we observe it, the magnetic field takes on a defined geometry only when we perform this nodal measurement. We are not simply looking at a field, we are making it exist in that shape. This brings us to another fundamental concept in Marsio's research, the levels of interaction. First level, the magnet by itself. As we've said, we can never know the magnetic field in purity, because we always need a second element to measure it, and that inevitably alters its form and characteristics. Second level, the magnet plus the sensor. And here something surprising happens. The shape that appears is the magnet's response to the sensor itself. Since the sensor acts like another magnet, what we're really seeing is their interaction, not the magnet's intrinsic field. Third level, two magnets interacting plus the sensor. Same story, what the sensor draws is not the direct interaction of the two magnets, but what would happen if a third magnet entered the system. Fourth level, three magnets in real interaction plus the sensor, and so on. Do you see the paradox? Every measurement, every point, does not reveal the present. It reveals the next level of interaction. In practice, this is nothing less than the collapse of the wave function, translated into the macroscopic world. To recap, even though I'm technically using a classical instrument here in the macroscopic domain, every single point measured along the field's perimeter is much more comparable to a wave function collapse. Each time the sensor flips polarity, collapse, then collapse again, and again.
Ow!
Until these geometries even hold true in 3D, collapse. And so yes, we must begin to rethink the distinction between real field and potential field. But this is only the beginning. There's so much more to say about the collapse of the wave function, but we'll pick up that conversation in the upcoming video on macro-superposition, where we'll explore more fascinating, real, and repeatable experiments that will blow your human minds. Stay tuned for the next video, which will be even stranger, when we explore the phenomenon of locked interaction, that precise point where two magnets freeze together, almost as if by magic. If you're enjoying this journey into magnetic and quantum science, give this video a simple like. It seems small, but it really helps us share this research with more curious minds. And if you'd like to keep following the experiments and the theories behind them, subscribe to the channel. It's completely free for you, but it makes a huge difference for us. Thank you so much. Greetings to all humans from X, your favorite alien.